because that's very interesting. Because my, in fact, my next question hinges on on capacity again and knowledge production. Since earlier, I think yourself, Mashilo, you said the concept of asset management is it's a fairly new concept, and in government, it's very recent. Like even if you read documents and papers on this subject, you'd see that there's not so much written. So my next question is, do professional bodies and voluntary association have any role whatsoever to play in assisting the state in maintaining its assets?
Bonke, I think you should take this one. This is directly up your alley.
I'm gonna show me the alley, but I'm gonna try and ask as best as I can. I think policymakers in South Africa, or vis-a-vis politicians, I'm not sure to what extent they listen to, let's say, us technocrats in terms of the decision-making metrics that informs the creation of an asset and the long-term planning for it from a capital budget, operational budget. Operational budget means you're going to have a planned maintenance budget. You know that it doesn't have to look cracked or compromised, but I must remove that those nuts and bolts after 5 years because I don't know what the integrity of that material is. And speaking of material, of course, built environment professionals have a responsibility to think like that because architects have material selection expertise. Depending on what they're designing. Similarly, engineers have material selection expertise from an operation and maintenance point of view. I've had the privilege of sitting in a few triple P bids, which were not awarded, by the way, but that's a different story. And you get to understand the various built environment professionals in the room, how they're thinking about it. Because why? It's going to affect their bottom line. There's Mashilo's why again. But it's not like they're gonna put or specify a substandard materials. It's gonna be fit for purpose. And I don't see that a lot. But so what is the role, you said, of voluntary bodies, professional associations, presumably like in the built environment and others? I think their role is advocacy, particularly voluntary associations, because the distinction really between voluntary associations and legislated statutory bodies deal with individuals, competence, registration, continuing professional development, that's one. Voluntary associations are issues of trade and commerce, industry issues that impact the same registered persons that the built environment professions statutory council are meant to regulate. And I think, and I'd like to see more advocacy. And I know the publications I read, the magazines I read, I don't have policymakers that read those magazines. So of course we have a role, and that role is that of advocacy, and it needs to continue. Mashilo, considering his background, is doing a PhD on that, to contribute to the knowledge base, knowledge production of the better performance of our assets. And just understanding the relationship and decision making, that it's not just about the horizon of the election cycle about the asset. It's an intergenerational asset that you're creating for the country to perform service delivery objectives, to meet socioeconomic objectives, and for the asset to continue to perform. Because if a wastewater treatment plant breaks down, then wait a minute now, we're going to create a public health crisis. And there's a correlation between the performance of and the design even, and even the quality of how it's built and maintained, and public health, because you're going to have a public health crisis. You're not going to have a situation where you can't land aircraft because none of the runway is full of potholes. I mean, where are you going to find that? You know, so luckily, there's no MEC that's going to fly and land the aircraft and the airplane skids off the runway and it says, okay, no, you are right. We need to extend or widen the runway, like the Mashishing example, where the MEC only saw the light when her own car capsized on that road. you know, and I'm sure technocrats, I'd like to believe the few that I talk to, say those things, but they're not listened to. They ask for the budgets, but they're not given the budgets. And then it costs us more later when that politician has been reshuffled or whatever, his party lost and he's moved on, and it still becomes a weight on the fiscus that you and I as taxpayers, forget that our professions, but as taxpayers, this is our money. And so we are mortgaging our children's future by what's happening now, because we're not doing things for posterity's sake, we're doing it for the next election cycle. So built environment professionals, of course, have a role of advocacy, but and hopefully they influence policymakers, because maybe they'll be with that interest and sit in the policymaking sphere as technocrats to influence the trajectory of how we treat and our attitude towards public infrastructure asset management. Maybe again, I'm being idealistic, but that's the fight I'd rather fight.
Yeah, we have to be idealistic at some point, Bonke. We otherwise we will die of this negativity that we see all around us. Mashilo, do you have anything to add to this question as well from Londi?
I think he said a mouthful. Look, we lack something called fact-based decision making. So that is very clear about how we make our decision. You can see that some of these things, and I concur, some of these things were based on a half for posterity's sake. A good example is the school in Tembisa, I think, where it was found that it was built on a wetland. I can tell you, there's no professional in their right mind that would have agreed to that. But there's some politician who felt, I want to cut a ribbon in Tembisa. And then I don't care what you say, you are building the school that I said you must build. Lo and behold, you can't open the school because it's full of water. That's the point that has been made.
And with that example, it so happens that the MEC of Education is from Tembisa, but that's another point.
But it's sad though. I think there's the you referred to the Auditor General's report, and maybe we can't expect the AG to fix all of that. But I mean, how does that happen? You know, and you know, South Africa is an interesting country. You have your CBOs, you know, your community-based organizations and civil society organizations that advocate for certain sectors of the country's economy or life, whether it's education, right to know campaign, health, and all of that. And I don't know which, and sometimes maybe we are that NGO as built environment professionals to make the noise that we need to make. You know, I think sometimes we're not sufficiently outraged by what we read and understanding the consequence of not acting, you know, and the failure to act, whether it's allocating sufficient resources to maintenance and the consequence of not doing so. And because if it's not affecting, I mean, that thing's going to be around for 40 years. So for the first 20 years, it's fine. So what are you worried about? You know?
Yeah.
We need to change that culture.
There's also an underlying, I think it's something, it's very nuanced that you are onto something. Okay, there's an underlying thing that I think we take for granted, and in always, so the CBOs, right? Most of them do what they need to do, and they're very vocal and stuff like that. And the other parties, our government, the point is made about the fact that they ignore this noise until something happens, some baby dies, fall into a pit toilet.
Yes.
And they're like, oh, that noise about the infrastructure, this is the cause. But it doesn't mean that they didn't know. Somebody told them that if you don't fix the toilet, something's going to happen. Now, because it's reality, you're now saying I'll build infrastructure. But I think part of that problem, it's something that's very nuanced, and it's a very South African, and I think we must be outraged about that more than anything else. It's about transparency. I think there's a lot of things that happen that are not transparent. So as a result, when CBOs and voluntary organizations, you're asking the question about their role, when they become very vocal, they're treated as the enemy of the state. Yeah. So they acquire the status of the enemy of the state. So I have a right not to listen to you because you are anti what I'm saying. And sometimes I think we tend to take that too far, that when somebody disagrees, is anti what I'm saying.
Yes.
And then I think majority of the time, professionals, particularly built environment professionals, are never listened to. I mean, let's not even, we went to Italy to go get electrical engineers for ESCOM. That's another. So they're never listened to, they're never respected. CBOs are just, so because their perception of truth is being treated as you're anti-progress and you're anti our people. You understand? So when the consequence of that we're advising happen later, when a child ends up in a pit toilet, it is as if these bodies were quiet. But if you go and you look, you find that, no, the guy at some point, and you are right, Mafiki, to say there was an advice. It's just that I get a sense that for transparency's sake, because we must say our government is the least transparent government on the planet. I mean, it's, in my opinion, it's close to North Korea. The way they are so untransparent, they are close to North Korea. And it's I mean, the simplest thing is right now that you are rolling out another asset. COVID vaccines is an asset. It's an in our eyes as asset managers, it's an asset.
Yes.
And so you have to have a plan about the rollout, about whatever. But you can go to any hospital. There's not even a simple thing as a pamphlet that tells the next person to say, these are the steps that you need to follow. Simple, basic thing. We have to be so secretive about even basic things. And that's part of the problem. That is why every time we pick up things after they happen. If we are transparent up front and says, guys, I'm building a school in Tembisa. This is why I'm building the school. This is what the school is going to do. That is what it's made up with. This is the reason why we're building the school. As I said, practical Giyama stuff. Believe you me, day one, the community will tell you, why are you building a school in the middle of water? They don't have to be engineers.
Yes.
Okay. Because you lack that basic thing of transparency, is we have to deal with the results all the time. And that will be my sort of final words around this thing, that the more transparent we are, the more Mlondi we're going to solve part of these problems. Because then I would know government is struggling with managing asset in the Reserve Bank. I can volunteer. I can say, I've got expertise. I'll volunteer my time for 6 months. I'll help you solve that problem. But because we are so secretive, none of us here knows what the real problem is. We just find out when the building collapsed that there was a building. And that's part of the nuanced problem that we have to deal with in this country.
Yeah.
Right.